Introduction to good poses. As always, in animation, one of the most important and probably the most important part is to create good poses. And that also applies to the face. When you create facial expressions, you must make sure that it transmits correctly and clearly the emotions of the character. So it is highly recommended that at the beginning you try to copy exactly the facial expressions that the actors make in your references. Because this way you'll practice learning to see the small details of the facial expressions. Although later, when you animate, you will most likely want to exaggerate them, it is important that you know how to create realistic expressions, because this way you will know what to exaggerate and how to exaggerate it to create good facial expressions. To create good facial poses, apart from knowing how to pose each part of the face correctly, you must have a global perception of the face. This includes coordinating the facial features so that you create a coherent overlap between them, and thus it feels that there are real muscles under the skin. And also you must take into account where the face opens to and the lines of action of the face, which in most cases will determine where the character's attention is.
Not now, Douglas, the birds are on!
In my day, we didn't stare at birds! We fought them!
Let me live my life!
This will give variation and asymmetry to the face, since normally we don't want to create symmetrical facial expressions. Would be great if you create some squash and stretch on the face throughout the animation, and make sure everything moves in arcs instead of straight lines. Remember that although you don't want your character's face to freeze in the animation, you don't want to be excessively changing the facial expressions either, so you will have to find a balance between creating completely new facial expressions and making small adjustments to the current facial expressions while keeping the essence of the facial expressions in the audience's mind. And like the rest of the body, you should pay attention to how it looks in the main camera, in the render camera, because in facial expressions it is even more important to pose the face from the main camera and not so much in a realistic way from all angles. In other words, in facial expressions we will tend to worry much more about how they look in the main camera and not so much of how they look from the front or from any other perspective view.
Nightmare! It's over! I'm human again!
The whole face is connected. When posing the face, remember that the whole face is connected. So don't make the mistake of creating poses in which you don't involve all the features. For example, if your character is surprised, don't just raise the eyebrows and open the mouth. Adjust the eyelids up and down. Adjust the controls under the eyes, adjust the cheeks, adjust the nose controls, however subtle might be. See what parts of the face should have tension. Find out how the muscles of the face would affect the facial features. Try to create facial expressions that are not only appealing and entertaining, but also coherent so that the whole face feels connected.
Focus!
The face is one of the most complex parts for many animators due to the amount of controls that it has, so it is highly recommended that at the beginning, when you create the main poses and the breakdowns, you only use the main controls of the face. This way, if you want to make adjustments later on before polishing, you can do them easily and cleanly. Because if you use all the controls from the beginning and you are not very careful when making adjustments, you can end up with controls that move in opposite directions, making a mess in your animation and making it much harder to polish. So my recommendation is to start with the main controls and polish your way into the secondary ones.
Hi!
Whoa, whoa, ladies, I'm a princess too!
Posing the face towards camera. In animation, we will tend to pose the controls so that they look good in the main camera. Generally, we will want to show all the facial expressions to the camera. But if we see our characters from a side view, we will probably want to see them completely from the side to get a better silhouette. We will tend to move the facial expressions so that they are visible on the main camera. Or if the character is talking, then probably we will want to move the lip sync a little more to the side so that it looks clear on camera. And obviously, depending on the animation style, we will exaggerate it more or less. The more cartoony the animation, the more we can modify or exaggerate the position of the lips so that they look good on the main camera. And the more realistic the animation is, the less we'll tend to exaggerate the position of the lips.
There, there, my little Monticello flower. Oh, look at her go!
The eyes is another part we will want to pose in relation to what we can see in camera, because many beginners tend to pose the eyes so that they are looking exactly to where they are supposed to be looking in three dimensions. But this is a mistake. Whenever you pose the eyes, you must make sure that they seem to be looking where you want them to look on the main camera, regardless of where they actually be looking on the 3D scene. To pose the eyes, you must think as if you were animating in two dimensions. The only important thing is where they seem to be looking from the main camera.
Subject appears disoriented.
Oh, Walter, what did you do?
Pigeons are everywhere and nobody notices them. It's the most perfect form a spy could take.
Unbird me right now. Stop, girl, seriously.
Line of action and asymmetrical opening of the face. The line of action will not only apply to the body of the character, but also to the face. As always, there will be exceptions, but as a general rule, you will want to have a line of action flowing from the center of the character's forehead through the nose to the chin. And although this might seem a bit obvious, many times the beginners tend to forget to adjust the nose so that a nice line of action flows through the character's face. And also, if you find points in your animation where the line of action flows from the character's face through the character's body, like for example one of the arms or some other part of the character's body, you will give an extra touch of appeal to your poses. By creating a line of action on the character's face, you are automatically opening the face to one side. The opening direction refers to the angle that is created between the mouth and the eyebrows, and most likely this angle will open to the direction where the character's attention is. Opening the face in a certain direction will also make the face asymmetrical, which is ideal, because like in the body, whenever you can create asymmetry in the facial expressions, your poses will be much more attractive. It is not necessary that every pose is hyper-asymmetric. Many times, just by adjusting different features of the face a little bit will be enough, as could be closing one eye a little more, putting more tension in one eyebrow than the other, or raising the smile a little more on one side, etc. In short, dedicating enough time, especially to the main poses, to try to create a little more asymmetry in their expressions will make your animations much more appealing.
know about this one.
Whoa, peanut toe.
Squash and a stretch. As with the rest of the body, you will want to create moments in which the face is squashed and stretched. In the squash, the eyebrows would go down and the jaw would go up, obviously affecting the rest of the face, like the cheeks that would also go up. So we could say that the center of the squash and stretch would be the eyes. We will want to apply the squash and stretch both in reactions and in transitions of changes of expressions. Sometimes in movements of the head, and in general to create contrast between main poses.
What the fudge?
And since this is animation, whenever you have a reaction that is a clear squash or a stretch, try to exaggerate it to transmit more clearly and intensely that emotion. When we want to make a transition from one facial expression to another, many times instead of a direct transition, we will want to squash the pose between the two expressions, as this would give an extra touch of fluidity and contrast to the animation. But keep in mind that sometimes you just want to create a more direct transition, so you would have to observe your animation and choose the transition that best suits and transmits the emotions that you want to animate.
Whoa, whoa, whoa! Wait! Did you see that?
Whenever your characters move the head, whether they move the whole body or mainly the head, you might want to add some squash on the face on the transition to create more contrast. Or if the character moves very fast, you might want to stretch the head in the transition frames to give a little more fluidity to the animation and create a more cartoony effect. When the character speaks, we can create a lot of squash and stretch by creating opposite movements between the mouth and the eyebrows. The more the mouth opens, the more the eyebrows rise, and the more the mouth closes, the more the eyebrows go down. And even if you want, you could add some squash and stretch to the actual head to emphasize this contrast.
Yes, it's real.
When you plan your animation and create the blocking with the main poses, it is a good idea to make sure that you have contrast between them. For example, exaggerate the squash and stretch as much as possible so that there is a clear contrast throughout the animation. But keep in mind that you don't have to always create squash or stretch poses. Sometimes there will be more neutral poses. And sometimes you might even want to leave some parts of the face relaxed or without any squash or stretch, while the other parts of the face are super exaggerated, as this will allow you to create funny facial expressions in many occasions.
Be Ralph Rex the Internet?
Yeah, since he is Wreck-It Ralph.
Yeah, but break the Internet, it's like a thing.
Right, it's just Wreck the Internet kind of sounds better, doesn't it?
You're not wrong.
Show that the characters think for themselves. Before deciding where to put the facial expressions, you should know what the character is thinking at that very moment and take into account the time it takes to react. While the character is thinking, before speaking or moving, the characters will modify their facial expressions according to what's happening in the animation. That is why it's very important that your references are as natural as possible, to capture all the small changes and details in the facial expressions. Practically always before the character performs any action, you will want it to be reflected in his facial expression, either by creating a specific facial expression a few frames before the physical anticipation of the movement, or by creating the facial expression at the same time of the physical anticipation of the movement.
Wow. Luca, that was hard to watch.
Generally, when the character is going to do an important action where decisivity is needed, like just before doing a big jump, or when the character is going to do something delicate, dangerous, that requires high attention, or other occasions where the character has to decide whether he wants to do something or not and decides to do it, you will most likely want to create a facial expression that shows the character's emotion before doing the action, and this will give you a lot of possibilities to create contrast and make your animations more entertaining. Even if the action doesn't require any effort or challenge, you will probably want to exaggerate that feeling in the character so that the audience perceives how brave he is. Obviously, for everything there will be exceptions, but basically the concept that I want you to remember is that normally you'll want to create a facial expression to show the audience how the characters feel about the next action they're gonna perform. But as I say, you don't always want to create a facial expression just before performing the action. That is why one of the most important parts to create believable animations are the eyes, because how the character moves the eyes will largely determine what the character thinks. In fact, many times you can convey a whole story just by animating the character's eyes. Because both the speed in which they move, the time they spend looking at something, and the amount of time they look at it will be key to convey to the audience how the characters feel about what's happening or what they have to do. So it is essential that you record good references, because what differentiates a good reference from an extremely good one are the eyes. Because if you get the character to move their eyes in a natural way, and you can convey the mental process of the characters through the eyes, your animations will be exponentially good and credible. Making a very good eye animation will not only help the audience to understand the animation, the story, and the personality of the character, but it will also help you to create more entertaining animations, since you will be able to show incoherences, fears, and mental conflicts of the character much more clearly, which will widen the range of stories that you will be able to create in your animations. For example, if you know how to animate the body mechanics of the character, you can animate the character jumping. If you know how to animate the face, you can animate the confidence of the character before jumping. But if you also know how to animate the eyes properly, you can also show the fear in your character and his insecurities before jumping, while trying to show to his friend that he's confident about it. So knowing how to animate the eyes will allow you to create an extra layer of depth in your animation. But don't forget to pose the body, since being able to convey to the audience how the characters feel with facial expressions doesn't mean that you can forget to convey the emotions in his body posture and gestures. Just before speaking, the characters already know what they're gonna say, therefore you want that to be reflected in their face. The exact point you want to create the facial expression will vary depending on the situation. Sometimes you will want to create it several frames before they start to speak, and other times at the same time of the physical anticipation of the action, but you will have to figure out for yourself the best way to do it in your animation.
Here, have some more.
No, gracias.
I mean, see?
That's what I thought you said!
Breathing will also play a very important role in conveying that the character is deciding to perform an action. So always keep that in mind when creating the facial expressions of anticipation. Because whether the character is deciding to perform an action that requires a lot of effort, or simply decides to speak, you will most likely need to create different in-betweens or even main poses where you can show how the character breathes before doing it. Anticipation and change of facial expression. Many times when we want to change the facial expression of the character, we will create an anticipation in his facial expression. And just like when performing a physical action, the more drastic the change of facial expression, the more we will want to exaggerate anticipation. The anticipation can be done in many ways, but basically we'll tend to create an opposite movement to the next facial expression. For example, by squashing the face just before the expression of surprise, by opening the eyes a little and raising the eyebrows just before squashing the face, or even by moving the lip sync slightly to one side just before moving it completely to the other side. And all this will also create more arcs on the facial features. Showing effort with the facial expressions. Although it's true that the facial pose you create will largely determine the believability of the character's effort, you could make your animation a lot better with just a few small adjustments along the animation. Once you have created the facial expression, and assuming you have exaggerated it to the maximum, a very easy trick to avoid the face to appear frozen when the character is making an effort is to use the in-betweener to create an intermediate pose around 80% as extreme as the main effort pose, and make that pose the starting point of the effort. In this way, throughout the effort, the facial expression will become more and more intense as the effort increases. And once this is done, if you want, you can experiment by adding some extra adjustments, like a vibration on the eyelid, some lip movement, or whatever you can think of. Also, when we make a great effort, we will tend to breathe deeper and more intensely, so if you exaggerate the perception in the facial features as well as in the body that the character is breathing hard, you will also make the audience perceive a greater effort. Finally, if you can think of any change you can make to the facial expression to show more intensely the effort of your character, you will make your animation more entertaining. So it is highly recommended that you record many references to get more ideas that you would most likely have not thought of. Because remember that animation studios want to see something original in your animations, so if you add some extra touch, even if it's subtle, to emphasize the story, I assure you they will love it. Easy in, easy out, overshoot, and settle. Aside from how you animate each part of the face individually, you must also have an overall perspective of the face, because at the end of the day, the audience will not look at each part of the face individually, but as one piece. So you must make sure that when there is a change in the facial expression, both when the expression starts to change and when it settles into the next pose, it feels as fluid and organic as possible. And we will achieve this to a large extent by creating good settles. For example, if someone scares your character, you will probably want to create an overshoot in the face so that we exaggerate the stretch for a couple of frames and then settle the facial features into a pose that is not so much exaggerated, but still showing the surprise in the facial features. Or if the character gets angry, we can make an overshoot so that the face flattens for a couple of frames a little bit more than in the final main pose. Although in most cases you most likely want to have a slowing into the facial expressions. When creating changes of facial expressions, generally we want to make fast transitions and then settle with a very small spacing over a few frames, so that the face will change relatively quickly, but will not be stopped as if the facial features had hit a wall, but in a very subtle way, with a very small spacing. And in the same way at the beginning of the changes of expression, we will generally want to have 1, 2, or 3 frames in which with a very small spacing the facial expressions begin to transition into the next pose, and thus we will be able to create much faster changes of expressions, giving it a more cartoony feeling, since if we create these small slow-in, slow-outs and overshoots, we can exaggerate much more the speed of the changes of expressions, which will allow us to make animations with much more contrast, and therefore more entertaining. And of course, this doesn't mean that all the facial expressions have to change from one another super fast, as sometimes you might want to create slow transitions for some reason.
Just a trim, please. Boris Egan
Traitors! The overlap of the facial features. Just like when you animate the rest of the body, you must decide which part of the body will lead the action. When you are going to make a change in the facial expression, apart from the anticipation, you must decide which part of the face will initiate the transition to the next pose. Keep in mind that sometimes you will have two parts of the face that will initiate the transition at the same time. It is not necessary that each and every part of the face are overlapped between each other with many frames. Many times the overlap you will create will be with the spacing. In other words, that even if two parts of the face start to move at the same time, if you make one of them move more than the others in the first couple of frames, that will also be perceived as overlap. And that's something that you will have to figure out how it looks better. Generally, you will want the jaw or the eyebrows to lead the action, since they are at the extremes of the face. But there will be times you will want the eyelids, the eyes, or the lips to lead the change in the facial expression. If you have lip sync in your animation, I highly recommend that you use it as a guide, because if you use it as a guide, you will create animations much more synchronized and coordinated with the audio, which will make them much more credible and entertaining.
It doesn't get much simpler than that. Now, what in this scenario would give you that good tingle?
Eating it? This is why I always carry 2 pieces of bread with me.
Take me to a website that's super intense and really nuts.
Oh, I only found one result.
When you create the overlap in the face, don't overlap all the facial features for many frames. Since the whole face is connected, they will overlap between each other by 2 frames at max. So if the character gets surprised, you might want to have a couple of frames of anticipation, then make the transition in about 3 or 4 frames where you will create the overlap between the facial features, and have 2 or 3 frames to settle the facial features, making some of them settle 1 or 2 frames before the others, in a way so that the whole face feels connected and organic.
Break the internet, it's like a thing.
Right, it's just wreck the internet kind of sounds better, doesn't it?
You're not wrong.
The arcs on the face. You will want to create arcs on the paths of action of the facial features. In the eyebrows, you will want to try as much as possible to make the inner ends of the eyebrows move, creating micro arcs, instead of just moving up and down. And we will achieve this by pulling both ends inwards and outwards in the transition, creating then small arcs in the paths of action. The nose, as is the part of the face that will attract most attention in relation to arcs in the path of action, so pay enough attention to make sure it moves smoothly and creates arcs. In the mouth, there are 2 key points we will want to move in arcs. One would be the lips as a whole, and the other the corners of the mouth. The basic idea of creating arcs in the lips as a whole is that the character does not move them only vertically, but instead the lips create small circles when speaking. Depending on how cartoony your animation is, you will want to exaggerate it more or less, but unless you are animating a hyper-realistic movie, you will always want to create arcs in the movements of the lips of the character. And for the corners of the mouth, you will also want them to move in arcs. The idea is that you don't want them to move back and forth, opening and closing on a straight line. And although many times this is how it will look in the early stages of the animation, once you go to polish the lip sync, make sure that the corners of the lips move in arcs. They don't need to be super big exaggerated arcs, even if they are very subtle will make your lip sync look much nicer.
Hello, Agent Sterling.
Let the beat drop.
The eyebrows. The eyebrows are one of the most expressive parts of the face. With them we can convey a very wide range of emotions, and although they look very simple, there are a couple things that you have to keep in mind when animating them. Most of the time they start to move with a slow out, and in most cases they will finish the movement with a slow in. But if you're animating a change of expression where the eyebrows move very quickly, such as in a fright, you will probably want to create an overshoot, where the eyebrows stay above the extreme for a couple of frames and then settle moving down a little. The eyebrows have a great variety of possibilities, and depending on the character, they will have more or less capacity to exaggerate the poses with the eyebrows. But as a general rule, you want to try to exaggerate them as much as you can to create entertaining poses. One of the most important parts when posing the eyebrows is that they are connected, because in 3D characters it is very easy to raise one eyebrow and forget about the other, but if you want the facial expression to be believable and organic, there has to be a line of action that flows through the eyebrows. Keep in mind that we have a muscle between the eyebrows with which we move them, because whenever you move them inwards or outwards, you must make sure they both move, otherwise the eyebrows will look disconnected and their movements will not be credible. When posing the eyebrows, you must also keep in mind that the inner part of the eyebrows will tend to move much more than the outer ends, so don't overanimate the outer ends of the eyebrows, as it can take away a lot of realism from your animation if you overdo it. The eyebrows help to convey where the character is looking at. If he is looking down, the eyebrows will most likely go down. If he is looking up, the eyebrows will most likely go up. And if the character is looking to one side or the other, the eyebrows will most likely open to whichever side he's looking. When you animate the eyebrows, both when you move them up and when you move them down, they will affect the eyelids, moving also the skin between them. For that reason, whenever you move the eyebrows, you have to consider how they will affect the eyelids. When you animate the eyebrows, try to make sure that they don't move in blocks. Analyze your reference and find out how they start and finish the movements, and if there is one eyebrow that leads the other. But again, keep in mind that the internal part of the eyebrows are connected, so even if you overlap them, make sure that they still feel connected and the energy flows from one another. And finally, although one frame might seem insignificant, if you overlap all the parts of the face by one frame, it will feel much more organic. And although it might be tedious to overlap each part of the face by one frame, if you take your time to overlap each part of the face by one frame, your animation will improve a lot.
Yes. It's real.
Introduction to the eyes and eyelids. The eyes are hands down the most important part of the face. Well animated eyes will give a huge amount of life and credibility to your characters, as they not only show where the character's attention is, they can show if he's lying, if he's afraid, shy, etc. In other words, where the eyes are looking at, how they move, how fast they move, how much they move, and how many times the character blinks or look at things will transmit a huge amount of information to the audience. So knowing how to animate the eyes is one of the most important parts of your career as an animator, and therefore having great references will be huge in order to create good animations that are full of emotions. How to pose the eyelids. The eyelids must be very well posed, because it's where the audience will be looking at most of the time. So in this lecture I will give you some guidelines to know how to pose the eyelids much better. Posing to camera is the most important thing. When posing the eyelids as well as the eyes, the most important thing is how they look from the main camera. So don't worry too much about how they look from other perspectives. Although that doesn't mean that you can completely forget about how they look from other perspectives. Just check other perspectives from time to time to make sure you're not doing crazy things with the eyelids, but focus most of the time on how they look from the render camera. When posing the eyelids, avoid creating weird poses with a lot of curves in them. Eyelids are quite simple, so try to make the lines either a simple curve or a straight line. Depending on the facial expression, you will want to vary which eyelid has a curved line and which one a straight line, or if both eyelids have curved lines or straight lines. So you will have to figure out how to pose the eyelids to best convey the expressions you want to convey. But also, as a general rule, you don't want to pose them creating almond shapes, as they are quite unnatural. Try to see in which way you can favor the curves of the eyelids so that they are not completely symmetrical up and down, nor left to right. When posing the eyelids, as well as the rest of the body, it is important that it has a nice line of action, so make sure you can draw a nice line between the eyes that flows from one eyelid to the other. When posing the eyelids, depending on the character's facial expression and emotions, you will want to pose them in one way or another. But if the character is relaxed, you will generally want the upper lids to be resting slightly over the top of the eye. But, since there are lots of animation styles, as well as characters and size of the eyes, there will be occasions where the eyelids practically never touch the eyes, so have a clear idea of what animation style you want to animate before starting to pose your character. And finally, if the eyes move, the eyelids move. Whenever you move the eyes of the character, you must adjust the eyelids. So for example, if the character looks up, the upper eyelids will be lifted, and the lower eyelids will also rise as well a little bit. If the character looks down, the lower eyelid will move down a little, and the upper eyelid will try to stay in the same point in relation to the eye. And the same goes when looking sideways. Slightly adjust the eyelids so that the audience can see how the movement of the eye affects the pose of the eyelid.
It's the most perfect form a spy could take.
Unbird me right now! Stop, girl, seriously!
The eyes. Pose the eyes in two dimensions. As I have already said a couple of times, you want to pose the eyes and eyelids in relation to how they look on the render camera, meaning that when I pose the eyes, I don't care at all to where they are really looking in the 3D scene. What matters to me is where they seem to be looking on the render camera. Do not trust where they seem to be looking at first sight. Move them, exaggerate them, and adjust them until they look perfect. Because many times when you start posing the eyes, they may seem that they are looking where you want them to look. But to make sure, try to move them even more to where they're supposed to be looking at. Because in animation, we tend to exaggerate the position of the eyes a lot so that they look good in two dimensions, regardless of where they are really looking in three dimensions. Tell the story with the eyes. As I mentioned before, when we watch a movie or when we talk to someone, we are 99% of the time looking at their eyes, and we are used to seeing them move. A quick glance, the speed of the blinking, how they open, or how open or closed the eyes are, says a lot about your characters, if they have anxiety, if they don't understand something, if they just realized something, if they are now remembering something, etc. Therefore, you must know how to tell the story with the eyes. Because if the eyes do not transmit anything, it will be very obvious to the audience, and it will be very difficult for them to empathize with the character. To put yourself in the skin of the character, try to think about what the character is supposed to be thinking, and observe how you move and how you feel. As you practice this, you will notice that there are certain movements and actions that will come naturally to you, which will make your characters much more unique. This is why many animators who find it hard to make natural references or are lazy when making references tend to have difficulties when giving depth to their characters, because although with the body it's easier to pretend to be spontaneous, it's very hard to move your eyes in your references as if everything was happening at that very moment. So it is very important that when you record your references, you imagine and strive to interpret your characters as if you didn't know what is going to happen next. And again, keep in mind that it's not easy to look, move the eyes, and move the attention of the character in a way that seems natural, since knowing what we want to animate makes it really hard to record the spontaneous references, and so the ideas and mental processes tend to seem pre-planned. So one of the main objectives when recording references is that you try to act as spontaneous as possible. The micro-movements of the eyes. The micro-movements of the eyes, as well as the blinks, help us to show that the character is still alive, and that is not completely frozen when the character is not moving. But on top of that, the micro-movements of the eyes can transmit many things and emotions to the audience. Also, since they are micro-movements, you don't need to create a blink to cover that movement of the eye. To keep the character alive is relatively simple. Just have the character make a couple micro-movements from time to time and in specific occasions. They don't need to move a lot or very often. If every now and then you make the character that is not moving have micro-movements in the eyes, it will keep them much more alive in the audience perception. This trick is especially effective when the character is listening to another one, since with these micro-movements you can transmit how the character that is listening changes the point of attention from one eye to the other. Because since this is something that we naturally do in real life, it will give an extra touch of credibility to your animation. As I said, micro-movements are good for much more than just keeping your character alive, as they can also convey a lot of emotions. Just like blinking, micro-eye movements can help convey many things, like what the characters are thinking and their emotions, as the movements of the eyes are connected to the mental process of the characters. So if you want to convey that the character is nervous, scared, or thinking about something very intensely, you might want to create several micro-movements in the eyes to convey an agitated mental process. Or if you want to convey that the character is calm, you will probably want to create the micro-movements more spaced between each other. Although you can always mix up things depending on what you want to convey.
We can't taste either?
All that stuff is in your body.
No smell, no taste.
Or touch. See?
The blinks. Blinks are not only useful to keep your character alive when it's doing nothing. Blinks can convey that the character is thinking, or the speed at which it's thinking. And even the fact that the character stops blinking can convey that it has thought about something important. Some of the common occasions for which you will make your characters blink are when they change the point where they are looking at, or when they change the thoughts in their head. Also, the speed and the number of blinks can transmit very different things. For example, if they blink very fast, you could say that they are confused, nervous, uncomfortable, but depending on how you animate the facial expressions and the personality of the character, it could be that he's rather intimidated, and instead of blinking fast, he blinks very little and keeps the eyes wide open. Therefore, you must have a clear idea about who your character is to choose wisely how to transmit the emotions through the blinks. Other reasons that could make the character not blink could be that he's perplexed thinking, scared, in shock, or angry. but don't let your characters without blinking for too long or they will look like a lifeless robot. There are so many types, speeds, and reasons why someone would blink. That is why it's essential that you watch movies and pay close attention to them in your day-to-day life. Analyze when the blinks occur, how many times they blink, what the person was doing or saying when they blinked, and most importantly, what do you perceive? What does the blink convey to you? Do you feel they are completely honest or they are lying about something? With practice, you will see more and more repeating patterns, and will notice more and more the little details that will make you an expert on why and how we human beings blink. Half blinks. Half blinks are a type of blink that is not quite common, as generally we will want to animate full blinks in the character. However, there are occasions when a half blink may better transmit the emotions you want to convey. A half blink is a blink that is not completed, and as a rule of thumb, you never want the top eyelid to go lower than the middle of the eye. Sometimes you will want to make half blinks move very little, and other times you will want them to reach the middle of the eye. The half blinks help to transmit confusion or even excitement in the characters. Of course, there are other occasions where you can animate half blinks, but since animation is an art, you can always find unique occasions in which a half blink could be perfect. So do not be afraid to experiment in your animations with the blinks of the character, because as long as they are animated correctly, meaning in a credible way, they will help to transmit much more intensely the emotions of the characters. It is clear that not all blinks will be the same, since depending on the personality and emotions of the character, they will vary. But it's important that you know how to animate a basic blink, so you have a foundation that you can modify as you wish. Whenever the character blinks or closes the eyes, you will want the upper eyelid to move much more than the lower one. Approximately 2/3 of the eye would be covered by the upper lid, and 1/3 by the lower one. So since the lower eyelid will move very little, they will both meet below the middle of the eye. However, this doesn't end here. To animate a smooth and organic blink, you will also want both eyelids to move together down for one frame after they touch. This way we will transmit how the inertia of the upper lid pushes slightly the lower eyelid down. Then they will separate, the upper eyelid will start to move upwards, and the lower eyelid will keep moving downwards. Okay, this would be the basic animation of the eyelids. Now we would have to involve the eyebrows and the cheeks, because although it's true that in real life when we blink we don't practically move the eyebrows nor the cheeks, in animation we want to exaggerate it a little bit, so that the whole face feels much more connected and organic. It doesn't have to be much, just a little subtle movement enough to be perceived. The jaw. In this section, we will not talk about the lip sync, but about how to animate the jaw in relation to the body movements, and how to take advantage of the jaw movements to give more fluidity and appeal to your animation. Remember that the jaw has quite a bit of mobility, so look for how to pose and exaggerate the line of action of the character's face, create more entertaining and fun poses, and create more squash and stretch in the character's face with the jaw. For example, if the character gestures with a head movement, something that can look very good is to take advantage of the moment when the jaw opens to make the head start moving to the opposite direction. so that not only creates a drag and overlap feeling, but also right after the head settles, the jaw closes, which will give an extra touch of overlap to the face. In fact, in most animations, you will want the jaw and the mouth to be the last parts in the face to settle, as this will give a lot of appeal to your animation.
Right, it's just wreck the internet. Kinda sounds better, doesn't it?
You're not wrong.
The nose. The nose is probably the easiest part of the character to animate, as generally there is not much movement involved, and the little movements of the nose will be a consequence of the movements of the rest of the face. In fact, I generally prefer to animate the nose in the polishing phase. Of course, for the main poses and specific facial expressions, I will pose the nose accordingly, but apart from that, I will leave it for the polishing phase. What I will do is simply go frame by frame synchronizing the movements of the corners of the nose with the corners of the mouth. Because if you look at the mirror, you can see how the major factor of how the corners of the nose move are how the corners of the mouth move. In fact, if you want, you could simply copy the curves of the graph editor of the corners of the mouth and paste them in the controls of the corners of the nose, although the values could be very different, so you will have to scale down the curves of the graph editor to make them much more subtle. Also, keep in mind that in some rigs, these controls could be inverted, so you might also have to flip them upside down to match the direction of the movements of the mouth. Now we only would have left to synchronize the tip of the nose with the opening and closing of the movements of the jaw, and we could do the same as before, copying the curves of the jaw and pasting them in the tip of the nose. And finally, consider if you want to overlap all these movements of the nose by one frame with the movements of the mouth, as this could give an extra touch of fluidity to your animation, and would be really easy to do, just selecting the whole curves of the nose and moving them one frame later. The cheeks and the ears. The cheeks and ears, as well as the nose, are relatively simple to animate, since they are directly related to what the rest of the face does. However, they are a little more complex, since the cheeks are relatively independent muscles. For example, if we open the mouth, the cheeks will stretch and lower a little. If we tightly close the eyes, the cheeks will go up. And if the character is relaxed, the cheeks will move in relation to the movements of the mouth. Usually, the cheeks will tend to move in the opposite direction of the eyebrows, creating a stronger squash and stretch effect. And one of the most important parts about the cheeks is the overlap you create in them, because since the whole face is connected, and in animation we want to exaggerate that connection, we also want to emphasize the overlap. So for example, when the jaw opens, we want to see it reflected all the way up to the lower eyelids, making them move down a little bit. And since we have the cheeks in between, the cheeks will also slightly move down. And finally, we want to create the fluidity in the face by creating overlap, so generally we will want to overlap the movements by one frame. Therefore, one frame after the mouth starts to open, the cheeks start to lower. And one frame after the cheeks start to go down as a reaction of the mouth opening, the lower lids will also start to go down in a very subtle way. This way we will create a very organic feeling of the face. The degree of exaggeration of the impact of the mouth movements on the cheeks and eyelids will depend on the character and animation style, but generally we will want to make the movements of the cheeks and lower eyelids much more subtle than those of the mouth. because the movements of the cheeks in relation to the eyebrows will be driven by the muscles. But the movements of the cheeks in relation to the jaw and mouth will only be driven by the skin stretching down. But anyways, in case of doubt, you can always look yourself in the mirror and see what the cheeks do when you make certain facial expressions. Depending on the character, or if the character makes very intense facial expressions, it is possible that coordinating a subtle movement in the ears in relation to the movements of the cheeks will give an extra touch of fluidity to your animation. However, I prefer to leave that for the polishing phase.
Imagine if I can make you, wait for it, drumroll please, disappear.
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 Why are you saying it like that?
For effect.
Introduction to advanced acting. In this section, you will learn how to go deeper into the acting of your character. So far, you have learned how to animate characters and give them personality. Now, you will learn how to give them depth, how to layer their emotions, how to give them contradictory emotions, and how to make the audience empathize more with the characters. In short, how to create a truly unique personality. Don't be lazy to experiment with different things, gestures, and re-recording references, as you will spend a few weeks creating the animation, so spending an extra couple of days recording references will cost you very little time, but will allow you to make much more unique and entertaining animations. When recording references, really get into the skin of the character. How do they feel? What's their relationship with the character they're interacting with? How long have they known each other for, etc. All these things will help you record much more specific references, since the fact that you're feeling what the character is supposed to be feeling will make your body language completely different. For example, if the character is interested in what the other character is saying, their body language may be pointing at them, or if they are very interested in what the other character is talking about, they might be leaning forward instead of leaning back. So knowing exactly how the character is feeling is key to conveying the story to the audience.
Could this be real? Is magic real?
Yes, it's real.
What about that?
Feel. Show. Say. When we do any action or say something, it's not as simple as just saying it. First, we will feel the emotion related to what we're gonna say. Then we will show it in our body language. And then we will say it. For example, if someone tells me something that makes me angry, first I will feel the anger, which I will instantly show in my facial expression. Then I will subconsciously adjust my body language according to the emotion that I'm feeling. And finally, I'm going to say what I wanna say.
Supposed to do it, Dad. They want us to do it this way.
I don't know that way. Why would they change math? Math is math.
Okay,
math,
Dad.
Is math.
Not the way you're supposed to do it, Dad. They want us to do it.
I don't know.
For example, if the character has just thought of something important, first they will feel the euphoria, then they will raise the eyebrows and open the eyes, and finally they will open the mouth to speak. You can show many emotions and personalities simply with this structure. For example, if someone tells me something that makes me angry, and I only show the anger in my face, but I show practically no emotion in my body language, I will convey more coldness, which could convey much more hatred than if also show much more the emotions with my body language. For example, in this case, does not seem that the character is feeling hate. but rather saturation or intense rage contained, but not necessarily hatred. Or for example, if the character has just seen the person he's secretly in love with, the face may show initial excitement or nervousness in the form of a surprise, and then the body language will show it. He may simply say hello with the hand, gesture with the head, remain silent and tense, or be all over the place. So it is very, very important that you know exactly how the character feels and get into their skin when recording references, as any subtlety can show different things in their emotions. For example, if he's feeling love but wants to look cool, we may want to show the surprise in their face at first, but since the character wants to look calm, we could relax a little bit the facial expression and show the excitement, nervousness or tension with the body language.
All good, brother?
All good, yeah, yeah.
Or for example, if your character is talking to someone that he admires, the emotions overflow him so much that you show intense excitement all at once, both in the face and in the body language. Sometimes we will be able to hide a little bit the emotions of our facial expression or even the body language, but since the first thing we do is to feel the first reaction, the surprise of what someone tells us, the trigger of the emotion would be much more difficult to hide because we did not expect it to happen. For this reason, if the character doesn't show any surprise at the words or action of the other characters, he will show that he doesn't care about them or that he's so used to that that does not surprise him. So, if we want to transmit hate, sometimes the character will almost not show any reaction, since to feel hate you must be emotionally saturated, which means that you are most likely already used to their hurtful comments or bad actions.
What's this?
Excuse me, are you getting that?
The accents. Accents give texture to the animation. Accents are the fastest, most intense, or specific moments of your animation. Animation accents are the accents of the body language. Just like words have accents in certain syllables, where the tone rises and becomes a little more intense, in animation the accents are the gestures or movements that call the attention of the audience. Accents are generally used to emphasize the most important parts of the dialogue. And although, obviously, when the character raises their pitch in a word, you will often want to create an accent, animation accents are especially important to emphasize the most important parts of the dialogue, regardless of the character's pitch.
We going to talk about it?
What?
The elephant in the room.
What elephant?
When the character speaks, you have to listen closely to the dialogue, and when recording references, try and research the accents that you want to create. Accents don't necessarily have to be super big or fast gestures. They simply have to stand out from the rest of the animation.
Brigitte? Oh my gosh, you've grown! Oh, everyone, this is May.
Hi, everyone.
Nice to meet you.
An accent can be a hand gesture, a change of pose, a specific movement, or a simple head nod.
Growth spell! We grow the can, and then the gas inside will grow with it.
And depending on what the character is saying, you will want to create the accents in one way or another.
We're supposed to be studying nature, not wrecking it.
Piss break!
It is important that there is variation in the accents of the animation, meaning that they are not all done with the same intensity or speed, nor that they are all done in the same way or with the same body parts. And I say this because sometimes it's very easy to create all the accents with the hand or with the head, but if you look for ways to create the accents in your animation in unique and original ways, your animation will be much more entertaining. That's why it's very important that you record many references for inspiration.
Welcome to the baby revolution.
And also, it's very important that you do not accentuate every single word, because I know that there are times that according to the dialogue may seem that you can accentuate everything and everywhere, but it's better to be specific with the accents than creating many repeated or generic ones.
You look just like your mother.
There are three moments in which you can animate the gestures: at the same time as the verbal accent, before the verbal accent, or after the verbal accent. If you animate the gestures before the verbal accent, you will transmit a lot of honesty, since by gesturing before the verbal accent, we are showing that we're feeling before saying, and this shows honesty. If you animate the gesture at the same time as the verbal accent, it will also transmit honesty. Therefore, if you can vary between gesturing before the verbal accent and at the same time as the verbal accent, you will create more contrast and variation in the animation, which will make it much more entertaining.
Humbling like me with the
goddess like you. But I promise, I will never forget you, Marco. Never.
Oh, I'm pretty sure I won't forget you either. Bye. Bye, Nico.
Also, accentuating gestures on specific words will help to emphasize their importance in the animation, so keep that in mind. If you want a word to be remembered by the audience, accentuate it with a physical gesture, but make sure that the strength and intensity of the gesture is credible in relation to the intensity of the word or sentence said. However, if you gesture after the verbal accent, things change because in this way you are speaking before showing it with the body language, and that conveys to the audience that the characters are not really feeling what they're saying, and therefore they are being dishonest, because instead of feeling, showing, and saying, they are saying it before showing it with the body language.
Please be subtle.
I'm having a baby! Is there a doctor? Or perhaps several security guards that can leave their post and help?
Please be subtle.
Security guards that can leave their post and help me! I'm having a baby!
Please be subtle.
I'm having a baby! Is there a doctor? Or perhaps several security guards that can leave their post and help?
Such a lovely place you've got here. Is it usually this empty?
The meaning behind the words. Regardless of whether the character is being sarcastic, is joking, lying, or saying the truth, they will have a much more specific meaning in their head. So you must figure out and extract the specific meaning that the characters feel when expressing those words. For example, a simple "I like you" can mean "you are fun," or "you are a good person," or "I feel attracted to you," or "you are interesting," etc., etc.
The nightmare! It's over! I'm human again!
As you can see, what we do is look for the most precise and exact meaning of what the character wants to say, and this is what we will use to animate the characters, since this way we will create a body language and gestures much more closer to the emotional meaning of the words and not so much to their literal meaning, which will allow us to make much more specific, believable, and natural animations. And of course, if you want to make an animation in which the character is lying, being sarcastic, or simply joking, this technique will be of immense help, because it will help you incorporate gestures and facial expressions that express the truth mixed with the words that the character uses, which will make your animations much more interesting, and it will be much easier to give them a more comical touch. In short, when you animate the character speaking, don't animate each word gesticulating what the character is literally saying. Look for the deep meaning of their words, and create your animation based on what the character is really feeling and wants to say, regardless of the words that he's using.
Whoa, whoa, whoa! Wait! Did you see that?
Whoa, whoa, whoa!
Wait! Did you see that?
Whoa, whoa, whoa!
Wait! Did you see that?
To extract the real meaning of a line of dialogue, the first thing we'll need to know is the character's personality and the whole context in which the animation takes place. Then we will analyze each word and sentence and try to find the words that are more specific to exactly what the character is feeling, and create the animation, body language, acting choices, and facial expressions based on that.
Storek Barak. Oh, it's a garek. Sagating. It don't go in like a dina tika. In rocket doke dick. Yo, go to gara. Nagasuka dake. Ah, da!
Jumpasa dawa.
Ah, sega stake. Sepatu.
Introduction to the lip sync. The lip sync is one of the most anticipated parts by many beginners. It must be that making the character speak is like finally giving it life. That feeling that your character is really alive. Anyway, the lip sync is an important part of your animation, and also a very delicate part, because if you exaggerate the lip sync too much, if it's too subtle for the intensity of the audio, or if it's not perfectly synchronized, it can take the audience out of the world of your animation, and although sometimes it's easy to fall into the temptation of making a quick lip sync to finish the animation, if you spend enough time making an entertaining and well-polished lip sync, it can improve your animation tremendously. Because the lip sync not only allows you to create many arcs and overlap in the face of your characters, it also allows you to show with much more intensity the emotions of the characters, because depending on how we animate the lip sync and the details we put in, we can generate completely unique sensations. So listen very carefully to the audio to find out how to represent it in the lip sync of your character in the best way possible. Listen very carefully to find all the moments where you could exaggerate it to improve the animation. Listen closely for all the little noises, breaths, or ticks that you might hear in the audio, so that you animate them in the lip sync of your character. Pay close attention to the dialogue that you have chosen to hear where the character takes a breath, if you can hear any noises of the lips, or any other noise made with the mouth, because if you can create unique moments in the animation of the mouth and lips, it will make your animation much more memorable. And as always, make sure that the poses you create are facing the main camera, the render camera, because at the end of the day, that's what the audience will see. Choose a good audio to animate. Before choosing an audio to animate, I highly recommend that you spend a few days looking for a good one, since you will be animating that audio for weeks and hours to come, and since much of the quality of your animation will be based on the audio you select, if you want to create an excellent animation, you will need an excellent audio. To choose a good audio to animate with, here are a few characteristics that you will want it to have. That it has pulses. Although at first might not seem important, it is very important, because the moment in which none of the characters speak are the perfect moments to improvise something and show some details that reveal more of the character's personality and how he feels. And also, if you listen carefully many times, you will realize that in the pulses you can hear the character breathing. So if you integrate that breathing in the animation of your character, it will get a much higher level of realism. That the audio has emotional contrast. This means that the audio that you choose is not a monologue in a single tone. Identify if you can make the character go through different emotions with that audio, since the contrast of emotions is largely what will make your animation entertaining. Do not choose popular audios or from animated movies. Although it is true that many times we want to animate the most memorable part of our favorite movie, most likely many animations have already been done with that audio. So I highly recommend you to try to choose a much less known audio, because if you choose audios from animated movies or very famous dialogues, the animators who analyze your portfolio when you apply to work at a studio will most likely have already seen some animation with that audio. And if your animation is not better than the ones that they have already seen, the comparison will make yours lose points. When you are choosing the audios, close your eyes. By this, I mean that you should not see the original performance of the actors of the audios you choose, because it will be much easier to imagine new scenarios and unique ideas if you do not have images associated with the audios you choose. So close your eyes and listen. Avoid choosing audios with a lot of background noise. When you select the audio, try to choose one as clean as possible, meaning that there are no background noises. But if you choose so and in the audio you can hear something extra from the environment, make sure you can integrate it in your animation in some way, because for example you don't want to hear in your animation in the forest a background noise of someone washing the dishes.
Not me! Oh, come on, just do it! What's the worst that could happen? Fine.
How to pose the lips. When you are posing the lips, you should not only take into account what letters are the characters pronouncing, but also their emotions, which will greatly affect the exaggeration of the lip sync. But also, since this is animation, we don't want to make a hyper-realistic lip sync. When we animate the lip sync, we want to exaggerate it and create contrast. We want to stylize the curves of the lips and make them more visually appealing. Another very important thing to keep in mind is that when you animate the lip sync, we will not pause the lips in the same way throughout the lip sync, even if the character is pronouncing the same letter, because when we speak, we connect the letters together, meaning we do not pronounce each letter separately. Depending on the letters before and after each letter, we will pause the lips in one way or another, so keep this in mind to create a fluid and coherent lip sync.
The elephant in the room.
What elephant?
And finally, keep in mind that the lip sync is a work of many passes, so don't expect to make the lip sync poses and animate it in one pass. Because due to the complexity of the sounds and that the letters are connected to each other, you will have to make many passes to analyze the lip sync frame by frame and letter by letter to make sure that the character pronounces correctly and at the perfect time the sound of the letter heard, so that the lip sync flows beautifully. In short, do not animate the lip sync posing each letter by itself, and make sure to exaggerate it and pose the lips in a more stylized way.
Excellent, Joyce.
You see her? I wish...
Stop.
It's not... I can't make people fall in love with you.
No, she's my best friend. 10 years ago.
The lip controls. Although at first glance it might seem dizzying to see so many controls in the lips, it actually is way simpler than it seems. The only thing is that you have to be careful not to hyper-exaggerate some of the controls to compensate the position of others. So when animating the lip sync, you must have concentration and discipline to animate it cleanly. On the other hand, you have the special controls, which you can find as both controls on the face or as sub-properties on one of the other controls. Generally, the controls with sub-properties will be the general controls of the character's face, and depending on who has created the rigs, the face will have some special controls or others, so before start animating, explore your rig to find all the possibilities it has, and so when you animate, you will know all the controls you have available. Letters that make the lips touch. The letters that make the lips touch are the B, F, M, P, and V. Since to pronounce these letters we must close the mouth, although they have some differences. In the B and the P, the sound is produced when the lips separate. These are called explosive letters, meaning that these are the letters that hold the air pressure and then release it.
You better be.
The more the characters shout or the more intensely they pronounce the B or the P, the more you will want to involve the cheeks, inflating them a little bit until the lips separate when pronouncing the letters, as this will help to convey more intensity in the dialogue.
I'm going to give you a push-pop.
Just for me!
No, to share.
I'm going to give you a push-pop.
Just for me!
I'm going to give you a push-pop.
Just for me!
In the M, the sound is produced when the lips close, meaning that we will pronounce the M before opening the mouth, and unlike the B and the P, the M is not explosive. So, if we want to intensify its pronunciation, what we will do is to press more intensely the lips together. And finally, for the F and V, the lower lip is positioned below the teeth. And if we want to intensify its pronunciation, we will raise the upper lip a little more, making the upper teeth more visible, at the same time we press harder the lower lips against them. And because of the predictability of these letters, I recommend that you start doing your lip sync by posing these letters first, so you will have a better perspective on how to pose the surrounding letters.
Save it. I want you to set this off so obvious. I want you to save it.
Oh, right.
Here it comes!
The tongue. The tongue is something often forgotten by beginner animators, and although it may seem that it doesn't move much, if the character is speaking, it's essential to pronounce some letters with the tongue. They are the TH, the D, T, L, N, R, and S. To pronounce the TH, we will put the tip of the tongue slightly between the teeth, and the sound of the letter will be produced while the tongue is in that pose. To pronounce the D, T, and R, we will position the tongue just behind our upper teeth, and the sound is produced when we take the tongue out of that pose. To pronounce the N and L, we will also touch the palate with our tongue, but the sound is produced while the tongue is in that pose. And lastly, to pronounce the S, we will not see the tongue, so we don't have to worry that much about it. However, if you hear that the character has a lisp, you will have to represent it in your animation by placing the tip of the tongue between the teeth when pronouncing the S. The amount of tongue that you want to stick out to represent the lisp will depend on how cartoony the animation is and the comic effect you want to give it. The jaw. When you animate the lip sync, don't open and close the jaw with each syllable the character pronounces, because the same way that when we post the lips, depending on the letters around each letter, we will post them in one way or another, with the jaw is the same. We don't open and close the jaw with each syllable the character pronounces. Instead, depending on the syllables before and after each syllable, the jaw movement will vary. For example, if I say morning, the jaw opens and closes with each syllable. However, if I say morning, you can see how the jaw opens and closes just one time. So analyze well your lip sync to avoid having the jaw of your character seem like it's motorized. The best way to find out how should the jaw move is to say the sentence yourself, but make sure you say the sentence at a normal pace, because if you say it too slowly, you will open and close the jaw many more times than normal. And finally, keep in mind that when the characters finish to say a sentence, you don't have to close the mouth each time. In fact, you will notice many times that when the characters stop speaking, you will leave a more relaxed version of the last pose of the mouth. And although it's true that sometimes we will close the jaw after speaking, you should find out what fits better for your animation, as it is not only a technical detail, but as almost anything, it can be used to emphasize certain emotions and give a more comical touch to your animation. The teeth. Although it may seem ridiculous that we have to animate the teeth, keep in mind that although we animate in 3D, we must pose the teeth in a graphic way, meaning that it would be much more similar to how you would draw them if you animated 2D characters, so that we will always pose the teeth in a way that they look the most visually appealing.
Understand me?
Yes, yes.
Good. Now get!
Although, keep in mind that we will not always want to see the teeth when the character says a letter or a word, meaning that there are occasions in which you will actually hide the teeth. Another thing to take into account is the asymmetry, because we want to create asymmetry between the teeth above and below. For this, once we have posed and polished the lips, we will give a polish pass on the teeth to ensure that you will always see one side more than the other. Almost always you want the top teeth to be seen slightly more than the lower ones, as this is the most natural way. But of course, in some occasions, you might actually want to show more the lower teeth, as this will give a specific feeling to the character. And finally, another super important thing is that the teeth cannot be moving. The audience must perceive that the teeth are stuck to the jaw, so you will have to make sure that when you animate the teeth, you make the transitions in the frames where the mouth is closed, so that when the mouth starts to open, the teeth are in the final pose and they don't move at all.
No smell, no taste,
or touch. See?
Okay, I get it.